Good evening. On this week's show, we're going to talk about the impact of PJTN in 2018 and our global reach, as well as moving forward into 2019, how we plan to combat the normalization of anti-Semitism globally. My name is Lori Cardoza Moore, and welcome to PJTN Online. If you're new to this program, Proclaiming Justice to the Nation's mission is to educate Christians about their biblical responsibility to stand with our Jewish brethren and defend the state of Israel against the rise of anti-Semitism. We accomplish that goal by producing award-winning documentary films and television programs, just like this one, to share with Christians, Jews, and all people of conscience around the world to educate and activate people in our communities to combat this ancient hatred of anti-Semitism. Of course, you can go to our website at pjtn.org to learn more throughout the program. Our programs that are award-winning are broadcasting now to 2.6 billion viewers each week. And Focus on Israel is one of our main programs. It's our flagship program, and we're going to talk a little bit more about that program and how you can tune in each week also to watch that one as well. It's an opportunity for you to be informed and be educated from a biblical perspective, using a biblical worldview to determine what you believe about Israel and what your responsibility is. And that's what we're here for, to help Christians connect those dots. Too often in Christianity throughout history, not only have we not stood with our Jewish brethren, but we have been involved in persecuting the Jews throughout history because of teachings within the New Testament. So I want to encourage you through the program tonight. If you have any questions, we're here. This program is geared toward you. We hear from Christians, Jews, and people of conscience really from all over the world each week asking us questions. So this is that opportunity to engage and have this conversation. So if you learn something tonight that you want more, you have a question about, or you want to learn more about, please, that's why we're here. Just go ahead and type it into Facebook. And of course, while we're here right now, please like us on Facebook so that you can share what we're doing here with your family and friends. You can also email me at comments@pjtn.org. If you don't want to ask the question right now on Facebook, you can always send me an email and we will get back to you with a response within 24 to 48 hours. So I look forward to hearing your feedback. Since our mission is to educate and activate Christians, Jews, and all people of conscience, this engagement platform is, as I said, created for you. We would also encourage you to become a PJTN watchman. We couldn't do what we do without more Christians and Jews around the world who have decided to take this initiative on. And we'll talk a little bit about that and our new chapter that we are going to be launching for PJTN in Johannesburg, South Africa, later this fall. I want to just talk about a scripture that a lot of us have heard in studying about Cain and Abel, studying in the book of Leviticus. And unfortunately, many Christians don't study the Old Testament because Christians have been taught or have perceived from their pastors or their Bible study teachers that the Old Testament is old. And so it's no longer relevant for us in the New Testament because we're New Testament or New Covenant believers. And unfortunately, because that teaching has been so pervasive, many Christians do not take the time to go back to the first five books of Moses, also called the Septuagint or the Torah, which is the first five books of the Bible. These are important because this is the plumb line. This is the foundation. This was the conversation that God had with Moses, and this was all written down for Israel throughout the generations. And of course, as Gentiles started to come into the faith of Judaism, as Gentiles started coming into the faith and embracing Israel's God, they also became part of the Commonwealth of Israel. So there's a lot of confusion and misunderstanding with regards to who the New Testament church is, or the New Covenant believers are. The simple message is crucial to having understanding, but in Leviticus chapter 19, verse 16, it says, you shall not stand by. The Lord told Moses to write this. You shall not stand by while your brother's blood is shed. And we, as I just said, too often Christians have not only stood by while Jews were persecuted throughout history, through Christian history, but Christians also played a role in persecuting the Jewish people. All we have to do is look back to through the books of history, the writings. We can see the pogroms. We can see the Inquisition. We can see the Holocaust. Christians were involved in persecuting the Jewish people. And many Christians did not stand with the Jews or tried to protect the Jews in their communities. For example, in the Holocaust, we know that there were many Christians in Germany and Poland and throughout Europe as Hitler was sweeping across the continent and taking one country after another after another. There are only 23,000 documented righteous Gentiles who actually stood up to protect their Jewish brethren, who hid Jews in their home, or fed them, or provided for them, or helped provide a way of escape and helped them travel to Israel. 23,000 is not very many righteous individuals or Christian individuals. Most Christians stood by and turned a blind eye to the persecution of the Jewish people. And we see anti-Semitism on the rise again. And of course, that's why PJTN is here, to wake up the church so that we do not remain silent, by and large, like what we did during the Holocaust. Those of you who tune in each week know that there is a deep desire for truth. You also sense within your spirit that something is not right, even within the churches. I hear from people who attend church on a weekly basis, and they feel like the messaging it's not meat. They're not getting fed. They're not being satisfied with the Word of God. They're hearing topical teachings from pastors. And unfortunately, we've seen this throughout the years, at least in modern time, where too often sermons are surrounded put together by what makes me feel good instead of what is truth, or topical teachings that don't go into the depth or the foundation of where that scripture came from. Instead, pastors are taking a scripture out of context and building their theology around that scripture. They say to make it relevant for the people that are sitting in the seat, but in the pews. But unfortunately, many people within the church are becoming disillusioned and disappointed with the church, and many are leaving. And of course, we hear from many Christians who are forming home groups, study groups, Bible study groups, where they're just studying the Bible. They're not building somebody's, you know, theology or taking a scripture out of context, but they're putting the scripture in the context. And of course, as I mentioned earlier, the Torah is the plumb line. And how do we know truth? How do we know that what we're reading, how do we know that what somebody's teaching is true? Well, we should be able, even if it's a New Testament verse or it's a principle within the New Testament, we should be able to find that same biblical principle within those first five books of Moses. God warned Moses that we are not to add to his word and we are not to take away from his word. And that word is that Torah. And unfortunately, we are guilty of doing that, taking and building our own, as I said, our own theology and our own belief system around scriptures that we think we know what that interpretation is. Or we use the statement, God told me. Well, God is not going to tell you in your prayer time or your quiet time with him. He's not going to tell you to do something that is contrary to his Torah. He said that I'm not a man that I should lie, and I am the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. I change not. So that is true about his word, and that's what he's speaking about. You recognize truth in your spirit when you hear it, and you also recognize lies. And ladies and gentlemen, we are living in the last days. And I think we can all clearly see the signs of the times. We can see the pressure. We can see the Gog and Magog war, the countries that are aligning together and building a coalition against Israel. to the north in the region of Gog and Magog. And we know that within the text of Scripture, what will eventually happen is those nations will march toward Jerusalem to try to take the nation or take that city. And God is going to draw them in, it says in the Scriptures. He's going to draw them into the Valley of Jehoshaphat, and he is going to judge them on account of what they did to his people, what they did to Israel. And that is that it that that is also true for us as Christians. That's why we started PJTN, because we are not educated. We're not taught how to stand with our Jewish brethren or why. So I want to just encourage you. Christians have adopted a teaching called replacement theology. And basically, if you're not familiar with replacement theology or supersessionism, it's basically a teaching where you hear your pastor or some other Christian leader or even some of your Christian friends who say that God is done. He's replaced Israel with the church. And God is no longer has that plan for the Jews, for Israel. They rejected the Messiah. He's given up on them, and now his focus now is turned toward the church. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that is not true. We as Christians, Gentiles, were grafted into the Commonwealth of Israel. Paul explained that, and unfortunately, we're not being taught that. And so it's important that we understand who we are and the role that we play, especially in this hour. We were grafted in, as I said, to the Commonwealth of Israel when God asked Cain where his brother was. I hear Christians who say, because I always use the term our Jewish brethren, and Christians say to me, why do you call the Jews our brethren? And they said, they're not our brethren, they're not believers. Well, they absolutely are our brethren. And just as Cain, God asked Cain where his brother was, Cain responded with the question, am I my brother's keeper? Same question that we hear today. Christians say, what do you mean the Jews are my brethren? They are our brethren. Gentiles were grafted in to the Commonwealth of Israel. They've been there. It's the prodigal son story. There's always been a brother who was with the father, who never left the father's side. It was the prodigal son who went off and prostituted himself, and he was the one who came back, and the father killed the fatted calf for and celebrated his return. As we look at events unfolding around the world, never could we have imagined that we would live to see the rise of anti-Semitism like what we saw in Germany historically happening in our generation. Unfortunately, this anti-Semitism is growing because the false accusation of Israel being an apartheid state. And many people have bought in, many Christians, many church denominations have bought into the lie that Israel is an apartheid state, that they're persecuting the Arabs that live in Israel. And ladies and gentlemen, that could not be further from the truth. And it's one of the reasons why we produced a documentary on this topic, on the boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement. But Israel is also accused of being an occupier, occupying Palestinian land. And you would be shocked to know that some of the people that are accusing Israel of occupying Arab land or Palestinian land are Christians, the church. If we know our Bible, God made a covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob and their descendants forever. And he repeated that covenant over and over and over. He stated it with Abraham, he said it to Isaac, and he repeated it with Jacob, to them and to their offspring, their generation, forever. And unfortunately, Christians in Israel, in Jerusalem, or in the Palestinian-controlled area are accusing Israel of occupying their land. Well, if we go back into Genesis and we read the story of Hagar, Ishmael, the descendants of Ishmael, God said he would make Ishmael 12 princes. They will be great, a great nation. But he was going to give Ishmael and his descendants the land east of Canaan. How can Christian theologians, pastors, priests, How can they justify their position by accusing Israel of being occupiers when the Bible says clearly that God gave the Arabs their land? It's in Saudi Arabia. It's in Jordan. It's not in the land of Canaan. Canaan was designated for the Israelites. And we have to go back to the Bible. We've got to go back to the Old Testament. We've got to go back to those scriptures and review. If you're not familiar with the whole boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement, I want to encourage you to go to our website, our store page, and order a copy of Boycott This. It is an award-winning documentary film that we produced. We decided to go over and see if Israel really was an apartheid state, and we decided to interview Arabs to find out. Because, you know, yes, we interviewed some Israelis, some Jews, but for the most part, we focused on the Arabs. We wanted to hear their story. And the narrative that we hear in the mainstream media and by some of these Christian theologians who are pushing the boycott movement and boycotting and divesting their church funds from businesses doing business in Israel, like, you know, Hewlett-Packard and Caterpillar and other organizations or companies that are doing business in Israel, you would think that these theologians would know their Bible and would not do that. But no, they're pushing the BDS movement. And if you remember, ladies and gentlemen, when Hitler started to persecute the Jews, the night before the persecution began, before he started to kill the Jews in Germany, they boycotted Jewish businesses. They told the Germans, do not shop in Jewish-owned stores. So it's very dangerous when we start seeing a boycott of Jewish businesses or a boycott of the Jewish state, Israel, we should all be paying close attention and we should be very concerned about what the next outcome is going to be. That's why, ladies and gentlemen, we must study and know our Bible. So go to our website, order the copy of the Boycott This documentary. Anti-Semitism, as I said, is growing among Christians, and it is replacement theology that historically is what has fueled anti-Semitism in Christianity, using New Testament scriptures to justify this unbiblical and heretical teaching. Anti-Semitism is born out of ignorance, and yes, biblical ignorance as well. The purpose of our award-winning programs is to confront ignorance with biblical truth. You should also order a copy of our award-winning documentary, The Forgotten People, Christianity and the Holocaust. That documentary, which has won numerous awards, it's broadcast all over the globe, but this film goes into the history of Christian anti-Semitism. Most Christians, when they come into the faith, or those who have been raised in the faith, have no idea about the history of Christian anti-Semitism. It's a wake-up call to the church in our generation to condemn this growing threat in our communities. God told the prophet Obadiah that in the latter days he was going to wipe out the descendants of Edom because they stood by while their brother Jacob was held in captivity and they did nothing. It's just like Cain and Abel. When God asked Cain, where is your brother? And Cain answered with a question, am I my brother's keeper? We will stand before Almighty God one day, ladies and gentlemen. We will have to give an account for what we did and what we didn't do for our Jewish brethren. Yes, they are our brethren. And yes, we should be standing with them. How will God judge the church? Because historically we have stood by. As I mentioned earlier, we stood by during the pogroms, during the Inquisition, during the Holocaust, and by and large, Christians are standing by today. The Lord said that he would bring the nations of the world into the valley of Jehoshaphat, and he would judge them on account of his people, Israel. So in the last days, ladies and gentlemen, think about this. We're going to be judged on how we treated Israel, how we treated our Jewish brethren. That should make all of us very nervous, because we will have to give an account, just like these nations, when God brings these nations into the valley of Jehoshaphat and judges them for the very same thing. Don't think that we won't be judged, because we will. Unfortunately, the anti-Semitism has now infiltrated our children's textbooks around the globe and the instructional materials that are being used in their classrooms. As children are being indoctrinated with revisionist history, including the lack of Holocaust education. I can't tell you how many times I get emails or phone calls or I speak to teachers at speaking events that I do, who tell me you would not believe how little, lacking our Holocaust education is. We're not teaching our children about the Holocaust like we used to. And we even have people who are saying that, you know, the Holocaust didn't happen. It's funny because in the documentary, The Forgotten People, we had General Eisenhower, who said, told everyone to document, take photographs, film everything that they see when they went to liberate the concentration camps, because he made the statement. He said, someday someone's going to come along and say this didn't happen. Well, here we are almost 80 years later, and that is coming true. What a prophetic word he spoke that day when he went in, when the Allied forces went in and liberated those concentration camps. It's just devastating, and it's all right there. It's history. It's written down. It's documented, and we don't even see. We're not even recognizing that we're repeating the mistakes of the past. It is critical for us to realize that we are jeopardizing our constitutional republic here in the United States by allowing unconstitutional Islamic content that favors the religion of Islam over all others by teaching them the tenets of the Islamic faith. That includes the hatred against the Jews and how they are an occupying force and they're taking Arab land. Through the now decades-old influence of Pearson published textbooks, ladies and gentlemen, and the biased instructional materials, we're feeding our children a daily dose of a distorted view of history, of our country, our Judeo-Christian values, and the nation of Israel. PJTN is on the front lines in this textbook battle, and we're going to talk a little bit about that. We are exposing this agenda, this hidden agenda. In fact, this month we are going to be launching a media campaign highlighting our white paper, our K-12 education white paper that we are going to be submitting to the Secretary of Education, highlighting the content in the textbooks, instructional materials, and the organizations that are educating our children in our public schools here in the United States. PJTN also is on the front line in engaging people in communities, getting parents, grandparents, and taxpaying citizens to get involved in taking back local control of their community. If you're not familiar with our PJTN nationwide campaign, I want to encourage you again, go to the website pjtn.org. There is a page where you can get involved and learn more about our advocacy, and there's great information there. We are actively working here in Tennessee, in Ohio, and in the state of Florida, although there are many states at different stages that are working. Parents and citizens are working locally in their school districts to try to change, to confront this, expose what's going on with the education system, to take back local control, eventually taking back and reestablishing the Judeo-Christian values that our nation was founded upon. So, ladies and gentlemen, we cannot keep silent, and your continued partnership and financial support will go a long way to make our biblical mandate possible. So I hope that you'll consider supporting us, not just with your prayers, but also with your financial support. We're on the front lines, and it comes with a cost. And I'm personally inviting you to please consider joining me in this battle. I am one person, but if I can equip you and give you the tools that you need to fight this battle in your local community, we can win this nation back. We can turn this nation back to America's greatness once again. As we begin a new year, Christians around the world must become engaged in this end time battle. Of course, for the hearts and the minds of our children, because they are the future. They are the next generation. We're going to show you another way you can help financially support PJTN and this important mission. We're going to watch a quick video, and then we're going to come back, and I'm going to tell you the story about how PJTN was founded. Let's take a look.
This month marks the 70th anniversary of the historic Declaration of the State of Israel. God's sovereign hand can be seen all over this land. Included in the celebrations is the opening of the American Embassy right here in Jerusalem. In honor of this celebration, PJTN is offering a special 70th anniversary package which includes a captivating new book and an award-winning DVD. Israel Rising is a unique visual story of Israel's miraculous journey from unforgiving desert to thriving nation. Thousands of years ago, the prophet Ezekiel foretold a future time in which the arid land of Israel would come alive for its people. Now this breathtaking book documents the fulfillment of this vision as rarely seen photographs from the 1880s to the 1940s are juxtaposed with recent photos of the same locations. This book will inspire and captivate you as it illuminates Israel's foretold awakening in a new and unforgettable way. In addition, you'll receive the award-winning documentary, Israel Indivisible, The Case for the Ancient Homeland. This inspiring film examines the many political twists and turns that make Israel the world's most controversial nation. From Abraham and the Promise to the issues facing the Jewish state today, the film examines the historical, archaeological, legal, and biblical foundations for the modern state of Israel. This is a limited time offer for these two remarkable resources for just a one-time gift of $70 today. Your generous donation will help ensure that PJTN stays on the front lines and in the headlines of all the important issues facing Israel and our Jewish brethren. So please go to pjtn.org today.
Thank you. And ladies and gentlemen, if you have your Bibles, I want to encourage you to pick up your Bible and turn to Joel chapter 3, verse 9, or if you have a Tanakh, it's going to be in chapter 4, verse 9. And in the verse, it says, proclaim this to the nations, prepare for war. So I want to tell you a little bit about the story of how PJTN was founded. You know, my background is in media. And of course, my husband is a two-time Emmy Award-winning director, and we've been broadcasting and programming and producing documentaries, music videos, media for most of our career, over 30 years of our career. And of course, with the awards that we've won, a lot of our work many years ago was in the country music world and also within the Christian music world. And when the Lord started to reveal to me the truth within the text of the Bible, I started connecting the dots and saying, you know, saying to myself and in my quiet time with the Lord, why isn't these truths that I'm seeing in the Word being taught from the pulpit? And I kind of brushed it off and thought, well, it's because they're, you know, every Sunday it seems like, you know, we've got a message for salvation. We want to reconvert everybody in the audience. And I know sometimes there's a few people that have not made that decision for the Lord, to give their life to the Lord. And we have to be sensitive to that. But we continue to be repetitive and preach a message that doesn't teach history. And that was one of the things that stood out for me. So after 9/11 was the wake-up call for me. And I remember that day. You probably remember where you were as well. But not when I watched the second plane fly into the tower, when I was home that morning, I knew that Amalek had come to our shores. Now you may be asking yourself, well, who is Amalek? Well, Amalek was the nation that had attacked Israel when the Lord was watching over and Moses was taking the Israelites from Egypt to the Promised Land, and they were wandering in the desert for 40 years. They were, all 12 tribes were there together. And Amalek came and attacked Israel from its rear guard, from the rear. And the people that were actually in the rear of all of those people, those hundreds of thousands, they say millions, over a million people that were traveling through the wilderness, the people in the back were the elderly, those who walk slower, women and children. And so when Amalek attacked the Israelites from the rear and they were not prepared, God told the Israelites they are never to forget what Amalek did. Amalek's strategy was to broadside, was to attack Israel and broadside her. And that's exactly what happened to us on 9/11, or blindside. We were blindsided. We did not expect that attack to happen, and it did. And unfortunately, when that happened, I knew that the world that we knew, in fact, I was homeschooling my children, the youngest of which was two at the time, and I said to my children, as we were all watching the events unfold that day on the screen of the television, I said to my children that the life that you know as children will not be the life that you know as adults, and how true that has become. It was 6 months after 9/11 that I was at a Bible study group with a group of Christian women, and I had heard that there was a Christian woman, a lobbyist in Alabama, who was introducing a resolution to support the state of Israel in her war on terror. And I heard the Lord say, I want you to get that resolution, I want you to do that in Tennessee. So we did. And of course, I had a lot of resistance trying to get that bill introduced. It was my first introduction to Christian anti-Semitism, but we were able, by the grace of God, to get it passed. And it was a year later that the Israeli Consul General from the Southeast, from Atlanta, came and paid a visit to Nashville and requested a meeting with me, and I met with him at the Federation here in Nashville. And during the course of the conversation, he asked me, he said, when was the last time you were in Israel? And I kind of chuckled, and I said, I've never been to Israel. And he was quite shocked that a Christian would go to the trouble that I would to help Israel in Tennessee to introduce this resolution, lobby for its passage, and not having ever been in Israel. So he told the Federation, the next trip, she's to be on it. And so I went to Israel, and I didn't know what to expect. Of course, I knew my Bible. I had been studying at this time. I had been studying the Bible for about 13 years, and I knew about the texts of Scripture, but I had never been. So when I went as a part of the Jewish community in Nashville. So my first trip to Israel was getting to see Israel through Jewish eyes. We didn't go to any of the Christian sites, although I went, you know, on a separate trip to a couple of them in Jerusalem. But for the most part, it was a completely Jewish trip, and it helped me to understand what I already knew about the Bible. Some of the pieces of the puzzle were put in place for me while I was there. But one of the key things that I saw that was lacking with in Israel was the lack of ability for the Israelis to communicate their side in the media. And this frustrated me because, of course, having a background in media, I know how important this is. And media, everybody has access to media today. We have the internet, we have televisions, we have radio, we have ways of communication to learn more and to find out information and really to visit another part of the world or another corner of the world from our own desktop or laptop in our own home. So as I saw the lack of the Israelis being able to communicate their side, I thought, you know, there was a scripture where we are commanded not to praise ourselves, but let another man praise you. And I thought, that's what we need to do. We're a Christian organization, or we're Christians, and we're involved in media. We need to go out there and tell Israel's story. As I came back and I started to talk to Christians about what I was learning in the Bible and what our role as Christians were to stand with Israel, I had a lot of interesting responses. Most Christians didn't, you know, had never been to Israel, number one. And number two, didn't know that God had a plan to continue because of replacement theology again and because of supersessionism. They didn't know that God was still in relationship with Israel and the Jewish people. And so as I communicated with Christians about this, they would say, no, God's done with them. Now it's all about the church. And I was studying in the scriptures in the book of Deuteronomy. And of course, if you still have your Bible, I want you to turn to Deuteronomy chapter 32 and read with me, starting at verse 36. It says, when the Lord will have judged his people, Israel, we know that his people are Israel, he shall relent regarding his servants. He's going to relent. He's going to clearly judge them, but then he's going to relent when he sees that enemy power progresses and none is saved or assisted. He will say, where is their God, the rock in whom they sought refuge, the fat of whose offerings they would eat. They would drink the wine of their libations. Let them stand and help you. Let them be a shelter for you. See now that I am He, and no God is with me. So the Lord right here is challenging. He's asking the Israelites who had turned and rebelled against Him and were worshiping foreign gods. He knows, and He's telling them, where are these gods that you worshiped? Why aren't they coming to your rescue? Verse 39 goes on to say, see now that I am He, and no God is with me. I put to death and I bring to life. I struck down and I will heal. Do you hear that? I struck down and I will heal. And there is no rescuer from my hand. For I, Yahweh, God, shall raise my hand to heaven and say, as I live forever, if I sharpen my flashing sword and my hand grasps judgment, I shall return vengeance upon my enemies, and upon those that hate me shall I bring retribution. I shall intoxicate my arrows with blood, and my sword shall devour flesh, because of the blood of corpse and captive, because of the earliest depredations of the enemy. O nations, now He's talking to the nations, not talking to Israel, sing the praises of His people. For He will avenge the blood of His servants. He will bring retribution upon His foes, and He will appease His land and His people. So no matter what Israel has done throughout her history, how she's turned and rebelled against God, and how she's worshiped golden calves and idols of foreign gods, God is going, He says right here, He's telling Moses, I will have mercy on Israel one day, and I will judge the nations. This is so important. I hear from Christians all the time who say, God is done with Israel. He is not done. And the only people who refuse to accept this truth in Deuteronomy are the same people who have adopted replacement theology and supersessionism, who believe that the Old Testament is no longer even worth reading. But if you look at the life of Yeshua, Yeshua came and fulfilled and lived everything Torah. He lived this life. He came as an example as to how we are to conduct our lives. He said He came only for the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So, ladies and gentlemen, it is so critically important that we study the Bible, not just the New Testament. We got to go back to the foundation. We have to understand the context of the New Testament, and we can't do that unless we go back to the Torah of Moses. Those first five books are so important. So I want to just show you a short video of what we've been able to accomplish in 2018, and there's going to be a quick video right after that one, and then we'll come back.
There are many worthy causes to give to, that no one can deny that. This is one of them. To make sophisticated documentaries on Israel's behalf coming from Christians is so monumental in its significance. This is where the battle is now. We must win the minds and hearts of people. They're lied to every day. That's why this has to be supported. We have to get into the media in every way we can. Lori, God bless you. God bless all the work you do. Thank you for having me. It was one of the great nights of my life. Thank you very much.
PJTN is idealistic, they are impassioned, they are informed. This is a personal issue for me. It should be a personal issue for every American, because in the ongoing struggle between right and wrong, between decency and profound terrorist evil, Israel cannot, must not stand alone.
PJTN to me is an organization that is a tip of the spear type of organization. She's willing to do hard things, take hard positions on matters that some people want to back away from.
We repeatedly see missiles being lobbed into communities in Israel and families being mutilated in their beds while they sleep.
The PJTN is one of these most wonderful organizations. They're really standing up for the facts, for the truth, and they share it objectively.
We see what's happening globally, how the Jews are being persecuted once again.
I would hope that more Christians here in the United States would speak out. I actually have a lot more clout than a couple of Zionists hanging out in Los Angeles.
How will you address the rise of global genocidal anti-Semitism?
Theological steps that PJTN takes that are founded on biblical doctrine are immensely important. They're crucial. So what PJTN brings to the world, to the Christian community, and to the Jewish community, is the most important thing you could ask for. When you combine that with this love and support of Israel, which is so important, and helping people awaken to what's going on in the world from a biblical or religious point of view, it just doesn't get much more important than that.
Laurie Moore is one of the great, great friends of the Jewish community. She does more single-handedly than most Jewish institutions combined.
Studying history, it's very clear that what starts with the Jews never ends only with the Jews. We must strongly stand against any anti-Semitic trends, for if not stopped, they'll cause harm to all of us, and we'll witness the downfall of our Judeo-Christian Western culture. Today, many people say there's no longer a need for a Jewish state, that Jews around the world no longer need a place of refuge. But anyone who has heard recent statistics about the worldwide rise in anti-Semitism would never make such a claim. The reality is that neo-Nazi groups and Nazi sympathizers are increasing around the world. Surveys show that over 1 billion people in the world harbor anti-Semitic attitudes. Close to 50% believe that Jews have too much power in the business world, and two-thirds of the world's population has never heard of the Holocaust or believe the historic accounts of it are inaccurate. If there's one thing history has taught the Jewish people, a place they can go in time of need is essential, and Israel fulfills that role. But the need for a Jewish state is not limited to being only a refuge for Jews. Jewish tradition in Israel grants full rights for women and people of all races, faiths, and gender. This tradition is what often makes Israel among the first countries to send doctors and field hospitals to any place where a natural disaster occurs, utilizing their medical advances to save lives worldwide. Muslims, Christians, and people of every faith, or those of no faith, have the freedom to worship or not worship as they choose. For Muslims, the Jewish state goes out of its way to provide this freedom. For example, every Israeli university gives students the option of deferring their exams during the month of Ramadan. The Knesset calls off all sessions at sunset during Ramadan to ensure that Muslim Knesset members can break their fast with the traditional iftar dinner. In an open and democratic manner, opportunities for education, advancement, and careers exist for all citizens in the Jewish state. Sadly, such rights and opportunities do not exist in any of the Muslim Arab states. For example, in neighboring Jordan, Jews cannot become citizens. And in Saudi Arabia, no non-Muslim can become a citizen. Saying that Israel must cease to exist as a Jewish state while accepting that other countries define themselves as Muslim is pure hypocrisy. In most of these countries, no rights exist for non-Muslims, women, and the LGBT community. Don't let yourself be manipulated by evil people with a wicked agenda. When the self-serving villains are in control, good people from all religions suffer. Muslims, Christians, and all people of conscience should stand proudly and show respect for a country that gives so much to the world in so many ways. Do your part. Do your research, and do what you can to make a difference. Because what happens in Israel does affect us all. This is not just a Jewish or just an Israeli problem. This is a problem for all humanity, for each and every one of us who believe in freedom and human rights. Learn more about what you can do at pjtn.org.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for tuning in tonight. And I just want to mention a couple of people who are on tonight and who have made comments. Ari said that I believe there were no Christian organizations standing up for the Jews during the Holocaust, only individuals. Ari, based on the research that we've done, yes, you're absolutely right. It wasn't an organization. It was individual people. And again, it further illustrates how important our organization is in mobilizing and getting this message out to Christians, because there wasn't a way of doing that back then. So thank you, Ari, for tuning in and sharing that with us. Urge is back on with us. He says that we can't divorce ourselves from the Old Testament, the standard by which Yeshua was judged to be the acceptable sacrifice without flaw nor defect was the Torah. Absolutely, Urge, you've been studying, you're studying to show yourself approved, and you're exactly right. Urge also went on to say, we've all rebelled against God, Jew and Gentile. And this is so true. Monique Crandon, thank you for sharing that article with us. For those of you who are tuned in, Monique has a link there from the BBC. This is an article that she's talked about before in our communications on our program. And of course, Kathy Johnson has joined us, and Josephine Moore. So again, I want to thank you all for tuning in. I hope that you'll continue to tune in each Wednesday night as we continue to reach out and find more Christians and educate them, as well as our Jewish brethren, because we do have members of the Jewish community who tune in, who watch not just this show, PJTN Online, but also tune in to watch our Focus on Israel shows and documentaries. I know because I hear from them, and it gives them great encouragement to know that there are Christians out there that love them and are trying to protect them without an agenda, but to be obedient to what God's word says. So again, please tune in every Wednesday night, 6 p.m. Encourage your family and friends and share this video once it posts. Share this video with your family and friends as well, especially Facebook friends. That's going to be our program for tonight. We'll continue this conversation next week. If you have any questions or comments, again, you can email me at comments@pjtn.org. And again, this is your opportunity to engage. So I'm here because you're here. And of course, if you want to learn more, you can also tune into our award-winning program focused on Israel on Daystar TV. And you can catch it Saturday evenings at 5:30 Eastern Time. And then you can also catch it Sunday night at midnight Eastern Time. And of course, we're filming all over. It's broadcasting all over the globe. So check your local listings. And of course, you can watch us on God TV every Wednesday at 2:30 Eastern Time. So you can also visit our events page on our website to see what events are coming up. We may have an event scheduled in your community where you can participate. I'll be in Florida in January. There'll be several opportunities for you to come and hear me if you're watching this program from the state of Florida. We'd love to see you there. I'd love to meet all of our Facebook fans and, of course, our Focus on Israel fans as well. Please continue to keep Israel and the Jewish people in your prayers. The hour is becoming darker and darker. I don't know if you've been following what's going on in France. There's been rioting and violence and looting going on. And of course, they were blaming the prime minister of France because he was raising taxes. And it took only 3 days for the people that were protesting to start blaming the Jews. It's unbelievable that this continues to happen in Europe. I don't know what is wrong with people in Europe. I don't know what's wrong with the church, for that matter, why this age-old hatred continues to go along. As I said earlier, ladies and gentlemen, it's complete ignorance. And yes, I will say a little stupidity too, because people are not studying to show themselves approved. So, of course, this is a topic that upsets me. Because the information is there, the facts are there, but people just don't confuse me with the facts. And that's even in the Christian church. So I want to encourage you also, pray for the peace of Jerusalem, that you may prosper who loves me. That's the word of God. And I also want to remind you to please send us your prayer requests and comments at PJTN or at comments@pjtn.org. And remember, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter and on Instagram. And, of course, subscribe to our PJTN TV page on YouTube. We've got plenty of videos there if you want to watch and learn some more. There's a lot of great teaching on our PJTN TV page on YouTube. And please sign up to become a subscriber tonight. I also just want to thank you again for joining us tonight. We do this for you to help educate and then activate Christians, Jews, and all people of conscience to stand with our Jewish brethren and Israel against the rise of anti-Semitism. So I want to thank you again. God bless you. And I look forward to seeing you next week right here on PJTN Online.
To support this program, send your tax-deductible gift to Proclaiming Justice to the Nations, P.O. Box 682711, Franklin, Tennessee 37068. You can also support PJTN online. Visit pjtn.org or call 1-877-873-9020.
Anti-Semitism has reached epic proportions, and Israel is now surrounded by nations who seek its destruction. For Israel to lose just one battle would mean losing everything. As Christians, it is our biblical responsibility to stand with our Jewish brethren and Israel. PJTN needs your help to reach more Christians with this urgent message. Please visit our website to become a member today and order our award-winning documentaries. You must decide that you won't be silent. Sign up now at pjtn.org. God bless you and thank you for your support and prayers.